case. So if it's not the same case, you have not the same treatment to give. So you have some parameters, not a lot of parameters, but some parameters to analyze, to quantify, to decide what you will do for the patient. The cardiac output, the preload, for example. Cold is because the patient, the resist, cold is mean that the extremity of the patient are very, the resistance is very high, and the extremity are cold. So it's because you have a very low output. So the flow will go to the brain, to the kidney, but not to the extremities. So it's because it's cold. And dry, because there is probably a very low preload. So for this patient, perhaps you will propose to inflate the patient, to perfuse the patient. Okay. For this patient, you will not perfuse the patient. It's cold, but the pressure, the preload is high. So if you give some perfusion, you will have a deleterious effect of the on the heart. So perhaps you will give some vasodilators, some inotropic drugs to increase the output, and after perhaps to inflate, but not. So some very important parameters to analyze before doing something. It's a clinical approach. It's not very complex. So, perhaps the light. Can we close the light? Because so, what mean hemodynamics? For example, you have two hertz here. The right and the and on the right, it seems to be good. Okay. With it seems to have a normal ejection fraction, and in the left part, this heart seems to have a very low ejection fraction. But this patient is alive. He speaks with you. He walks. So, despite a low ejection fraction, you can measure it. Perhaps the hemodynamics is okay to permit to be alive. Okay, so hemodynamics is the group of parameters you can analyze to say yes, the life of the patient is possible despite a very low function. So now we will see what kind of parameters we will analyze for that. So it's the hemodynamic. So with hemodynamic, we want to know something. Usually we want to record, to have an information about the pressure inside the heart, because we know that the right part and the left part are not the same level of pressure. We want to see it. We want to measure the cardiac output because it's the main role of the heart, you agree with me. And with these two measurements, two acquisitions, we can calculate something, vascular resistance, that are very important, for example, for the lung, and sometimes valvular stenosis. But today, we know that echo is the main technique to do that. On the other part, we want sometimes to have valvular regurgitation information, and sometimes to be able to measure or to analyze some shunt inside the heart. So, hemodynamic, the reference technique to record those parameters is the invasive approach. Okay? We can do that, we will see why and how. We can do that by echo, but the main technique is the invasive approach. So, the two main things we do is during a right catheterization. We put a flexible probe in the vein, and we push the probe from the peripheral vein to the heart. The first cavity we will record is the right atrium. We stop, we record the pressure. The second cavity will be the right ventricle. We record the pressure. And after we push in the downstream, in the stream of the blood, and we record the pressure in the pulmonary artery. And when we push with, after inflating a balloon, we can wedge the probe in some small pulmonary artery and record, in fact, the pressure in the left atrium. We are not in the left atrium, but the pressure you record when you have the balloon inflated is, in fact, the pressure in the left atrium. Okay? So, by a very simple, it's not too complex to do. This technique is not complex to do. You can have all the pressure right atrium, left atrium. Okay? So, the if you want the left ventricle after load, you can measure it by a blood pressure with a non-invasive technique. The second thing we do is to measure the cardiac output by a thermodilution technique. When the probe is in the pulmonary artery, you have you inject some cold bolus of water and you record at the tip of the catheter the change of the temperature. And you have a curve over time, and the area under the curve is related to the cardiac output. Okay? So we can do two things very easy. Right pressure measurement and cardiac output. Sometimes you need to do something else. You can do oximetry if there is a shunt somewhere in the heart and you are not able to.
Sorry, Eric. So how often do you do that? I imagine you don't do that for every patient.
When you do that? Or
yeah.
That?
What the indication for catheterization?
Okay. I just explain what we do with the main technique, with the reference technique that is an invasive technique. We will see. Just it's just to explain the historical technique. We can do oximetry. We are not of a lot of oximetry to do in our daily practice, but we can do that. By the past, we were able to see regurgitation, but today is not necessary. One other thing we can do is the left heart catheterization. But in fact, we never do left heart catheterization to precisely record the pressure, just because we do a lot of coronarography. And when you do coronarography, you have to measure and to monitor the pressure over time to be sure there is nothing bad that occurs. So, what can we measure? Not a lot of things, in fact. We have to, it's important to see what we need, what we record by the invasive technique, because with echo, we want to have the same measurement. And we will see that it's not so easy to do. So, with the invasive technique, we have the right pressure, so the right atrial pressure, the right ventricular pressure, the pulmonary arterial pressure, and the left arterial pressure, okay, and the cardiac output. It's not a lot of parameters, but very important parameters. And after, we can calculate some new parameters. Two are very important, the pulmonary resistance and the vascular resistance. We will see after. So I give you here the normal value for the pressure in the left and the right cavities. So here is an example of catheterization we have done in the cath lab. So there is not a lot of results, just any results. You have here the left afterload with the artery pressure here, the left atrial pressure, the right ventricular pressure, the cardiac output here, and the vascular resistance. And here, the pulmonary artery pressure and the right artery pressure. So, few parameters, okay? But important parameters. So, if you want to do hemodynamics with echo, you need to propose something like that, okay? So, of course, we want to change that. We do not want to continue to do invasive approach because it takes time. There is a bleeding risk. In fact, it's well tolerated. Infectious risk, and so on. But the main problem is the time consuming, because in the cath lab, you have a lot of things to do, and you prefer the hemodynamics approach will be done by the echo than by the invasive approach, because it takes time, and you have a lot of coronarography to do, you have a lot of angioplasty to do, and you have a lot of new things to do, for example, to the TAVI, the mitral flip implantation, the left appendage closure. All these new techniques needs time, and if you do a catheterization, you have no time to do the other things. So it's very important to be able to do that with echo. But in fact, by the past, we have an increase in the echo technique, and the main disease we can approach and we can investigate by the echo were the valvulopathies. But we continue to do a lot of catheterization. So why? There is a problem here. Because of specific indication, and we will see. We have two main indications today that need the invasive approach. If you want to do transplantation for patients, you have to be sure, absolutely sure, of the pulmonary resistance, for example, the mean pulmonary pressure, and other indications like pulmonary hypertension need a precise measurement of the mean pulmonary artery. And we'll see that it's not so simple to do. So the indication to do for François, catheterization are here. We have guidelines that say it's not reasonable to do the hemodynamic measurement with echo for this disease. And here it's for heart failure when you have to decide of transplantation for a patient. And now we have a big problem with the pulmonary hypertension, because the diagnosis is made by the catheterization.
Can we put the microphone a bit
more? Like that. Okay. It's better? No. So so you know, hypertension, pulmonary hypertension is a problem because the prognosis could be very bad. Some young patients have, for example, sclerodermia, and in this case you can have pulmonary hypertension with a very bad prognosis. And your problem is to be sure to not miss this patient. And sometimes the level of the pulmonary hypertension is not very high and probably not be able to be discovered by the echo. So you, because of the prognosis and because of the age of the patient, you have to be sure you cannot miss this patient. So it's the reason why we do a lot, and an increasing number of this catheterization. Because when you do the diagnosis, you have to do the follow-up, because you have to introduce the treatment, the specific treatment, and after you have to be sure the treatment is okay for the patient. And you cannot do that with the echo. So it's a big problem. We won't do that by the echo, but we are not able to do it. We will see. So it's the situation in Caen today. So we do a lot in the cath lab, a lot of coronarography, a lot of angioplasty, and as you can see here, not zero catheterization, more than 600. So it means you need a guy to do that for 1 year, because the time you need to do the catheterization is around half an hour. So if you have more than 600 catheterization to do, it's simple to see you need one or two guys to do that. Okay? And when you use two guys to do that, you cannot use the same guy for coronarography and angioplasty. Okay? But I don't know if we are happy that they do that, because if they do not that, we have to do that. Okay? So the number of catheterization increase because the diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension increase. Because there is now treatment. If you have no treatment, you will not search the disease. But if you have treatment, you want to search and treat, okay? It's because of the treatment. If you have no treatment, okay. So now the problem. Does this whole machine can do something like invasive approach? We will focus just on two things, the pressure measurement and the cardiac output measurement. Because after, if you have the pressure and the cardiac output, you can calculate a lot of things, like pulmonary resistance, like valvular stenosis. But it's not the topic. The topic is really pressure measurement and cardiac output. So what we want, the main parameters we want, is the right prelude. Does the prelude is high, low? It's very important for the treatment. The pulmonary artery pressure, yes, it's very important to know. And the left ventricular prelude. Not a lot of things, just that. And after, the cardiac output. So one, two, three, four things. Okay? It's not a lot. So we will see if it's possible. So when one other thing important is when you want to know the relevance of a technique. It depends what you want to. It depends the answer you want. It depends if you are in the diagnosis. It depends if you speak about screening. It's not the same thing. It depends if you speak about follow-up. So not exactly the same thing. So we will see. The first thing we can do by echo, it's 20 years ago, the first paper showed it was possible, is to have something like the thermodilution, but by echo. So we have a technique by echo, you know that, perhaps, is the calculation of the cardiac output. It's not too complex to do. We just the Doppler to have the velocity in a tube, and we just need the anatomic information of this tube to calculate the cross-sectional area and to calculate the outflow. It's okay? It's simple. We do that at the level of the left ventricular outflow tract. We can try to measure it in other sites, but in fact it's not so reproducible. So the main result is obtained here at the left ventricular outflow tract. We can try to do that at the pulmonary outflow tract, but you are not sure of the size of the pulmonary artery, because the pulmonary artery is not so easy to see by echo. You can do that at the level of the mitral annulus, but the motion of the mitral annulus is very important. So when you put the pulse windows, you are not sure it's always at the same level of the mitral annulus. So the best is to put and to analyze here, but we know that there is a motion of the aorta, so sometimes not always a good measurement. But the validation paper exists, but they are very old. As you can see here, it's IT. So it's a very old paper with not a lot of patients, as you can see. In clinical practice, usually we have not a lot of patients for the validation paper. Okay. So these authors show that the method was good to do that. And some other authors have shown that there is some acceptable repeatability of the technique if we do the measurements on a short time or medium term in the time, you can find nearly always the same value. So it seems to be a good approach for this kind of measurement. Okay? So it seems to be reasonable to do the measurements of the cardiac output by the echo technique. So in practice, it's a good technique, and we use it, we will see after, every day for that. The best approach is the approach in the left ventricular output. Right. I show you some simple example. I do not a selection. It's I take it as they arrive. For this patient, we have echo measurement of 2.5 liter per meters per square meter, and by the invasive approach, we have something at the same level. The problem is not to find the same measurement. The problem is to find the same range. It means, does the patient have high output, normal output, or low output? It's the main result you want to have. So here we can say by echo and by the invasive approach that the patient seems to have a normal output, okay? For these patients, the output seems to be low in the with the echo approach and with the invasive approach. Here we have the same kind of result. So for our clinical practice, the cardiac output measurements is for us relevant. So now, after the cardiac output, we have to measure the preload to all the pressure that occur in the right part of the heart. So the right atrium measurement, the left ventricular measurement, and the pulmonary pressure measurement. For the right ventricular preload.
A stupid question. Don't you ever measure the cardiac output by measuring stroke volume and heart rate?
When we want, if we compare cardiac output by volume and by Doppler. It's a question?
Yes, yeah, we have. I mean, I actually thought that cardiac output was measured by looking at the volume change between systole and diastole and then multiplying by heart rate.
Sorry, professor.
Oh, sorry.
It's for example, if you use the 3D probe, for example, to follow the volume.
Yes, I understand. You mean it's better to do that by the volume than by the Doppler?
I'm not saying it's better.
No, yes. We
any difference.
It's not easy to, if you do not 3D echo, perhaps we'll have some, we have always difference between the measurement with the volume or with the Doppler because of lots of reasons. If you do, when you do a measurement of the volume, you are not sure to have all the volume, okay? If you do the measurement with the 3D, you can think that you have all the volume, you have some other problem that are not that can explain that you have not the same results, but...
Yeah, it's maybe a comment. The problem of this approach is the measurement of the size of the aorta. That's the biggest problem here, but the Doppler envelope is actually very, very, very robust. And when you go to volumes, volumes are actually not that easy to measure accurate neither, and not on 3D also.
Yeah.
So it really depends a bit. It's like what you see that a lot of people are using is just the VTI of the aorta or the pulmonary artery, and then compare that, especially in one patient.
Yes, if you want to monitor one patient, yeah. If you want to follow during the... Yeah. You treat a patient, you give some inotropic drugs, you want to see if you have an increase. It's just a monitoring. Yeah. But
it's very robust.
It's robust. But you can have a lot of reason to find difference between the two. For example, the heart rate. Just the heart rate. If you calculate the cardiac output, you have to introduce the heart rate. It can change. If you have arrhythmia, it's difficult. So a lot of reason, but the volume is not so good as we can think, because there are lots of possibility to error. We try to do that, but the result is not good. So for the right ventricular preload, we said before that it's very important to for the output. If you have a low preload or a high preload, it's very important. So we want the level of the preload, but in fact we cannot give a measurement, a precise measurement. We just give the answer: the preload is low, the preload is high, just by looking at the vena cava. So it's a semi-quantitative approach, is not a quantitative approach. So it's just for screening. And even if you want for follow-up, if you give some diuretics to a patient, you can redo the echo a long time after and to see if you have a deflate of the vena cava. But it's not as precise as the invasive technique. Some example here. As you can see, it's not so easy to follow the vena cava to be sure that there is a change of his size during quiet breathing. It's a normal response here. During the inflate, the size of the vena cava will be reduced, and you can say here probably the preload is low, but you are not sure and you cannot have the exact level. So you cannot give a measurement that you can add to the gradient we will see after. So the next things we have to measure is the right ventricular systolic pressure. In your clinical practice, it's something interesting to have the pressure in the right ventricle, but it's not linked with some disease. It's just a mechanism of adaptation to something, perhaps to pulmonary stenosis or to pulmonary artery high pressure. So it's important to have this information, but it's not directly linked to disease or to a prognosis. But it's very important to have this information, because you can better understand the mechanism of the right ventricle and the function of the right ventricle. If you analyze a right ventricle with some radius of his motion, his contraction, is perhaps because of a hypertension. It's not the same thing if you have a radius in the contractility with high pressure or a radius of the contractility with low pressure. It's not the same thing. So can we record this pressure in the right ventricle? In fact, not. We cannot directly take the measurement. We just can record the gradient between the right ventricle and the right atrium, and at the maximal velocity, calculate the maximal gradient between the two. And these gradients reflect the pressure gradient in the two cavities. But as we said just before, we cannot add the right atrial pressure. We are not able to give the right ventricular pressure. Okay? Some example here. Here you have a dilated right ventricle with some dyskinesia of the septum. It's interesting to know if the pressure are increased or not. You want to measure it with the tricuspid regurgitation, but as you can see, we have no tricuspid regurgitation. So in this case, we are not able to measure it, but probably the level of pressure is high because we are over 3 meters per second. Okay, so So probably there is a high pressure in this right ventricle, but we cannot measure it. One other example here. This right ventricle is dilated, and there is some dyskinesia of the septum. And we can measure, because there is a tricuspid regurgitation with a good spectrum, so we can measure it. And as you can see, the gradient is very high. So it means that you have almost 100 millimeters of mercury between the right atrium and the right ventricle. So the pressure are high, but you cannot give the number of the pressure, but it's high. And it's important to report that with the right ventricular function. So you have a little dysfunction of the right ventricle, but very high pressure. So it's not the same thing if you had dysfunction and low pressure. Okay. One other example to show you that it's not always easy to measure the pressure or to have an idea of the pressure. Sometimes you have some restrictive hemodynamic restrictive situation, and in this case you have a right ventricular dysfunction with probably high pressure, we don't know, but you have a tricuspid regurgitation that seems to be important. And if you want to measure the pressure, you have a change of the gradient during the breathing, because when you inflate, the volume in the right ventricle increases the pressure and will decrease the contractility of the right ventricle. So you have a reduction of the tricuspid regurgitation. So in this case, when you have it's a restrictive pattern, you cannot measure very easy the pressure in the right ventricular cavity. The last thing we can see, we want to have for the right part of the heart is the pulmonary pressure. As I said before, it's very important because there is a prognosis value. But today, the definition is very precise and need a right heart catheterization. But for these measurements, the guideline said you cannot measure it by the echo, so you need catheterization. So why do that? But in your practice, we measure it. But in fact, if you have to give the answer, you have to do the measurement by the catheterization. Just to explain you, because it's not the same situation if you are, for example, an adult patient with a left heart disease, for example, with ischemic disease and systemic hypertension, probably the pulmonary mean pressure will increase a little, because there is probably some times when perhaps his blood pressure is not well equilibrated. So sometimes this patient will have an increase in his left pressure, and in fact in his right pressure in the pulmonary artery. But it's not a prognosis value, because if you give diuretics, if you increase the treatment, probably you will have a fall in the pressure, and in terms of prognosis is not very important. But in one of it's something different if you have a young people with scleroderma, for example. Probably if there is a pulmonary disease, she had a pulmonary artery disease, you will have a little increase in the pulmonary pressure, but this increase is mean a very bad prognosis. So it's not the same case. The prognosis depends on the disease, and you have to discover this patient, because if you do not, the patient can die. And now you have treatment, and if you have treatment, you have to discover this patient and to treat. So we can try to measure the pulmonary mean pressure, but you do not, because the guidelines say you have not to do, but you can try to do it. you record the pulmonary insufficiency in the pulmonary artery and the early diastolic regurg is linked to the pulmonary mean pressure, and if you have the gradient here you are able to have an idea about the mean pressure in the pulmonary artery. So we do that, but we know that if we have some suspicion of a pulmonary hypertension we will do a catheterization. So it's clearly written here, if you suspect pulmonary hypertension you do a catheterization, and if the catheterization confirms the diagnosis you will have to do the follow-up by the catheterization. So in fact the message is you cannot diagnose the pulmonary hypertension by echo. So what do we do? You are useful for the screening of the patient. And how to screen? We will screen with a very simple technique, the tricuspid regurgitation with the measurement of the gradient or just with the velocity of the maximal velocity. So the guidelines say if the maximal velocity is under 2.8, probably there is no pulmonary hypertension. If the velocity is over 3.5, probably you have pulmonary hypertension. And between the two, you have to find something else to help you to decide to do the catheterization. Okay? So, to help you, you have some other markers of hypertension. Some markers are just the dilatation of the right ventricle. Here, some paradoxal kinetics of the septum, and so on and so. So it's a statistical approach. So I show you some example here of sign of probability of hypertension. Here you have a dilatation of the right ventricle with the motion of the septum is not normal, as you can see. So I show you 3D, but you do that in 2D, it's not a problem. It's for the morphological approach, and for the hemodynamic approach, here you have the pulmonary artery, we not see very well, as I said, the pulmonary artery with the pulmonary insufficiency here, and when you do Doppler in the this regurgitant flow, you will record here the pulmonary regurgitant flow, and you can see that the maximal velocity is very high, is high, over 2.5, so probably the main pulmonary is high. But in this case, it's not difficult to recognize. The problem is when you have very small increase. The definition is 25 millimeters. In echocardiography, you're not able to measure that. Okay? So it's the reason why you have to do catheterization, because of the prognosis. One other sign is that the pulsate Doppler flow in the left, in the right outflow track change, the pattern change with acceleration, a very short acceleration time and sometime a double peak.
There's a question, Eric, because we've been seeing a lot of movies with weird movement of the septum, and there are also the weird movement of the septum in other pathologies like LBBB.
How to recognize?
Yeah, could you just comment on what are the differences? And because I think it's interesting to mention that.
The timing is not the same. For example, if you speak about the septal flash during CRT, because it's the main, the timing of the the septal flash is during isovolemic contraction, so you have early motion of the septum because of the left bundle block branch. But here you have a motion during, when it's pressure overload, you have systolic motion of the septum in the left ventricle because of the increase of the pressure in the right ventricle. But you can have volume overload of the right ventricle. In this case, is during diastolic time when you have, if you have a big pulmonary insufficiency during the diastolic time. You have all the volume come arrive in the right ventricle, and there is an increasing of the right ventricle filling, and at this moment the septum will change the shape and be in the left ventricle. So it depends of the time of the cycle.
Maybe just a comment, it's indeed that the timing is extremely important, but in the first day we heard talks about measuring stiffness, for example, because when you look at the septum, it's important to see whether it's the motion is induced by pressure differences in left and right or by contraction. So probably in one you will have a stiffer piece of tissue compared to the other. So there again, we are missing information since we cannot directly measure pressures. But maybe in the future, the kind of the shear wave analysis might add information there.
The answer was just on the shape and what we have in the 2D image or 3D image. But of course, we need to have the timing, the pressure, the gradient, because it's of course. But just on the image, if you just segment and want to compare CRT and right ventricular pressure or volume overload, you can compare by the shape and the timing of the shape. So at the end, we just have a probabilistic approach, not diagnosis, not precise measurement, just a probabilistic approach. And the message is, if you have sufficient markers to propose a catheterization. So if you see a young people that she has sclerodermia, and you will be very, very, you will measure the tricuspid regurgitation with very, very clear, with a very clear manner. You have to have a very clear measurement. If you are not able to measure it, it means, and if the patient has a little dyspnea, you will propose a catheterization. Okay, you are really in the screening, not in the diagnosis. Your role is the screening. Yeah. So, one other thing we wanted to do but we cannot is the measurement of the pulmonary resistance. But we need to have the cardiac output and the pressure, the real level of the pressure. We have not very difficult. Some authors to calculate it, but in fact it will not work. So it's not recommended to do that with echo. Okay? You cannot decide a transplantation or not just with these results. Okay? It's not good. So we have not to do that. So in fact, for the right part, we are a little disappointed. We can say that we have a main role for the screening of the patient, but not for other things. Okay, it's for the diagnosis is difficult, for the follow-up is difficult. If you make the diagnosis of pulmonary hypertension, you need to follow the patient with the catheterization, not with the echo. You can do echo. Just in our daily practice, we do echo, but in fact, you have to do catheterization. So for the left part, we just focus on the preload, because as for the right part, it's difficult to have information of the pressure inside the left ventricle. Sorry, the left part. So what can we do for the left part of the heart? We want to know what is the level of the preload of the left ventricle. We have to be able to have information about the left atrium pressure and the diastolic left ventricular pressure. So how we do that? By echo. We know that we cannot obtain a direct measure of the pressure, so we need to find something to do that. And what we have is the flow patterns between the pulmonary veins and the left atrium, and between the left atrium and the left ventricle. And so we will follow the changing of the shape of these two flow to interpret the pressure, the gradient, the pressure gradient and the pressure in the cavities. So the two flow patterns can change not only because of the pressure gradients, but for many reasons. So it's the reason why it's very difficult to interpret. For example, the age of the patient, we have seen that yesterday, the age of the patient can change the pattern because of the stiffness of the heart that change over the time. But other things can change. The diastolic function, it's, you know, because you have a decrease in the diastolic function, you have probably an increase in the pressure, but it's not so simple because you have the relaxation, you have the stiffness of the heart. Other factors can change the shape, but some factors are well cloned and other factors are uncloned. So it's difficult. So what we do, the first thing we measure is the transmitral flow. The first part of the transmitral flow is represented by the E wave, and the E wave represents the gradient between the left atrium and the left ventricle during the early phase of the diastole, and it's related to the relaxation of the heart. And the late phase is the A wave, and more related to the compliance and the stiffness of the heart. So the change of these two flow will give us information about the gradient. So we record it at the top of the mitral valve here. We measure the peak A, the peak E wave, the peak A wave, and the duration time of the decrease of the E wave. The problem, as I said, is that this shape change over time. So you can have some shape for old patients that are the same than young patients with disease. So it's very difficult to understand. Does this shape is a disease or not? The other reason for the changing of the shape is the gradient pressure. So it's what we want to analyze, but with the pressure gradient, the change is not easy to understand because at the beginning you have a big E wave, a little A wave, but for the small increase in the pressure, you have a decrease in the E wave, and longer time of the decrease of the E wave, and an increase in the A wave. But if the pressure increases a lot, you will have a shape that is the same as the shape of the normal pressure. So high pressure and normal pressure give the same shape. So it's a problem. So we cannot really appreciate the pressure with this changing shape of the transmitral flow. So we have to do something, and what we do is to inject in this flow the relaxation. So we record the relaxation, the mechanical relaxation of the heart at the level of the mitral annulus. Here you have a DTI signal with the S wave, systolic wave, the E prime wave, and the A prime wave. The E prime wave represents the recoil of the mitral annulus, so the relaxation of the heart. So if you have a good relaxation, the E prime wave is very high. So if you have a high E wave, because of normal or increasing pressure, if you calculate the ratio with an E prime wave, if you have a normal E prime wave because of a normal relaxation, you have the result will be very low. But if you have a reduction of the relaxation, the ratio will be high. So it's what we calculate. And if we calculate the ratio of E and E prime, we can find a correlation with the pressure. If you do not that, the E wave is at the same level with low and high filling pressure. Okay, so because we are not, we cannot understand the changing shape of the transmitter flow, we need to add something else, and something is a mechanistic approach, is the relaxation function. Okay, the problem with the E prime wave is that you record the E prime wave on the mitral annulus, on the lateral part of the heart, for example. If you have infarction at this level, the E prime will be low, and what you record is not a global relaxation, it's a local information. The problem is that you, with this formula, you have global information for the transmitter flow and a local information. So it will be preferable to have some global relaxation information, the global mechanistic information. Now,
so just why not using like the distance between the valve and the apex, for instance? Like we were saying, it's an easy approximation of GLS. That would be global. No?
It's ring motion, but that's the same. Right? So
the idea is to now we do a mean between the lateral and the septal part of the heart, because if you just look at the lateral part, you can have some errors because it's very local approach. What you want is to say the relaxation of the heart, not the relaxation of the lateral part of the heart. So how to introduce that? Perhaps with some global information. You can, perhaps with 3D, you are able to calculate the peak filling rate. For example, if you had the change of the volume or the global GLS, you can perhaps inject that. But today, with the guideline, is not the case. With the guideline, we have to calculate the mean E prime between the septum and the lateral wave. We have to approach a more global information. Okay.
But it's again that Doppler is much more robust in measuring than any 2D or whatever based measurement. So that's why it's easiest to do this on the Doppler.
Yes. Under that, the explanation is that when you increase in age, the E prime will change always in the same direction, not a U shape of the changing. When you have a change like a U shape, the beginning and the end have the same shape, you cannot understand anything because it's the same. But if you have a regular change, you can understand something. So it's because you have a regular change of the E prime that you can use it. You know that if it's small, it means it's bad. When it's high, it's good, and when it becomes small, the disease is increased. Okay. But sometimes it do not work. We will not see that, but it's a principle. So for the mitral transmitral flow, it's okay. It's the main flow we analyze, and we had to include the relaxation to understand it very well. The second flow we can use is very interesting. It's the venous flow. And just to be simple, the venous flow, you have two flow, the systolic wave and the diastolic wave. Normally, the systolic wave is bigger than the diastolic wave. And you have at the end of the venous flow, the backward A wave. The backward A wave occurs during the atrial contraction because you have not valvularization of the pulmonary veins. The flow go backward when the left atrium contracts. So this wave is small. Why? Because when the atrium is contracting, it's more easy to go in the left ventricle than to go backward. So normally, it's easier to go forward than to go backward. So in a normal case, the A wave is small. Okay. If you have an increase in this wave, probably it becomes more difficult to go forward and it becomes easier to go backward. So it's simple to analyze, and it can be helpful for us. So some example here you have this example show that it's not so easy to record it. We have seen it yesterday.
What standard view do you use for that?
The apical for cavities view. I will.
The question was, what's the standard view?
Yes. The answer is the four cavities used with the new machine is easier to do, but it's remained difficult because it's the depth is very important and the spectrum is not always very good. So it's the reason why it's not the main technique, because the mitral flow is very easy to record and always good. But this is very interesting, but not so easy to do. So we have something else to help us to understand the flow and the pressure. For example, the left atrium. If you have a patient with a very small left atrium, probably the pressure for this patient were never very high. If you have an increase in the preload of the left ventricle, probably the size of the left atrium will increase. So if you see a patient with a small left atrium, you can say probably the pressure, the preload is low. So it's a good information. Some other markers were proposed to help us to understand the pressure gradient. For example, the color propagation flow. But the problem today is that it's the clinician that measure something on the image, and we are not robust. So if we have a software that do that for us automatically, probably the result will be better. But today, it's not very good because we are not robust to measure something here. So how we use all these flow, it's not too complex. I will show you. We have guidelines. So the main parameter is we have to explain, and we have to explain that each 2 years because we have guidelines that change. So it's not so easy. Today, if you want to see if a patient if the preload of the patient is high or low, the first thing to look at is the ejection fraction. Does the ejection fraction is normal, or does you have a reduction of the ejection fraction? If the ejection fraction is normal, you have to apply this process. You have to measure the average E'. Does the result is high? If the result is high, probably the pressure are high. You have to analyze the relaxation, it means the diastolic relaxation. Does the E' is normal on the lateral and septal level? And at the end, the left atrium volume, if the left atrium volume is small, probably the pressure is small. Tricuspid regurgitation, if the maximal velocity of the tricuspid regurg is low, probably there is no. So it's probably. So at the end, if you are in this case with less than 50% of these parameters positive, probably the pressure is low. Okay? And no, you mean no diastolic dysfunction, it means probably no high pressure. Okay? Here, probably high pressure, and on the middle, the gray zone. So, there's a statistical approach. What you have to understand is that we are not able to give a measurement. We are not with the invasive approach. The invasive approach is very, very clear. It's a measurement, and you know for each measurement if it's good or not good, the prognosis, and so on and so. With the echo, you have just some global information, some probabilistic information, and to decide after what you will do. If the ejection fraction is low, is always a statistical approach. So we have to explain that to your young clinician, and it's very important because it's, despite its statistical approach, it can help us and the patient in the daily practice. So we are a little disappointed because we have no direct measurement. We just have some probabilistic approach, but we have to do with that. So at the end, all the information we have the flow on the right part, the tricuspid flow, the right pressure, but just by looking at the vena cava. And on the left, we have the pulmonary flow, the Doppler flow, well, the aortic outflow. Some information that can help us to understand the shape of the transmitter flow. Okay, with that, we are able to say if how is the hemodynamics of the patient and what we can do for him in terms of standard treatment. If we have to decide for non-standard treatment, for example, for pulmonary hypertension treatment because of the prognosis, for transplantation, for surgery, complex surgery, we will need catheterization. But for the standard treatment, we can do that, and we do that every day for all patients. Does it help the clinician in the real life? Here it's a paper that shows a lot of patients that were analyzed in a clinical point of view, echographic and hemodynamically. And the paper say that echo is better than just the clinical approach. Okay, fine. Good information. And for the treatment, echo and hemodynamic for the standard treatment, it means diuretics, vasodilators, and so, it's the same level of information. We can do that for that. But if we want something more complex, it's not sufficient.
From your previous life, how long does it take on average to perform all those acquisitions?
If you want to do a very nice exam, it takes 20 minutes. Yes. And day after day, we add some new acquisition for 3D and so. So it takes time. But if you do that every day, you can increase the speed of the exam. But it takes time. It's not an emergency exam. It's an exam that you, because you have to treat the patient. If the question is what does I do for this patient? It takes you 20 minutes to do the exam. So some example here it's a patient with the question was a kidney transplantation. So as I said, the first thing you have to do is to measure the ejection fraction, and sometimes it's difficult. So for example here, it's not so easy to apply the decision tree because we are not sure of the ejection fraction, probably low. But in this case, you can do some contrast echo that will help you to measure the ejection fraction. And after that, so for this patient, the ejection fraction is low, under 50%. And after, you can measure all two parameters. For example, here we have probably low right ventricular pressure, so probably low pulmonary pressure, because it's under 2.5. But you can see that in the right ventricular outflow tract, the shape of the flow could be understood as increasing the pressure because the acceleration time is short. But the guidelines say if the tricuspid regurgitation is low, probably there is no pulmonary artery, high pressure in the pulmonary artery. The cardiac output seems to be okay. And concerning the left atrial pressure, probably high because you have ratio EA ratio that is increasing. The pulmonary flow, not easy to interpret, seems to show increasing filling pressure because you have a big backward A wave, inversion of the ratio of the S and D wave. You have an increase of the size of the left atrium, so probably the pressure is, seems to be high. But here, it's not in the same direction. It seems that the pressure probably seems to be lower. But you have to take in account many parameters. So in fact, for this patient, probably there is an increase in the pressure. So we said right ventricular pressure probably low, pulmonary artery pressure probably low, yes, under 25 millimeters of mercury, and pulmonary wedge pressure, it means left atrial pressure probably high, and it's the case, it's high. And the cardiac output is the same. Yeah, we have a little difference between the cardiac output, but in the index it's the same. I don't know why, perhaps a mistake here in the measurement. So we are in the same level of results. So for this patient there is no difference. For another patient, it's a patient awaiting for transplantation. So we know that we are not, we need the catheterization for this patient, but we can explore it. So the ejection fraction is very low, so it's the first part of the decision tree. And after, we want to give information about pulmonary pressure. We cannot because we have no, because the patient probably have a lot of diuretics, and with diuretics, it becomes it could be difficult to have some flow. For example, here, if you give a lot of diuretics, sometimes the tricuspid regurg will disappear because the volume of the right ventricle will decrease. And we can confirm that here. The right atrial pressure is low, so I think the patient's the preload is very low for this patient. The cardiac output is low, as you can see here, and the pressure in the heart, in the left part of the heart, probably high, okay? Because you have an increase in the size of the left atrium, you have a change in the shape of the pulmonary vein flow, and you have a ratio that is not normal here. So probably the pressure are high. And in fact, the pressure were correct, not very high for this patient. We give the answer the gray zone or high. So it's not always the same value. One other example here. With it's a young patient with heart transplant since 25 years. So the heart becomes restrictive with fibrosis, but the systolic function is good. So we have to decide for a new transplantation. So we do the echo, but of course we need the invasive evaluation. So for this patient, we can say that probably the pulmonary pressure is low because of the tricuspid regurgitation. Probably the right atrial pressure is low, so a good level of diuretics. But probably we have here we have a restrictive pattern of the pulmonary flow. And if we look at the left atrial pressure, probably they are low if we take in account all these parameters. And what does the what is the answer? The answer is not so simple. They say that there is post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. So we are not able to see that. So, and one other thing we are not able to measure is the pulmonary vascular resistance that is important for the prognosis and for the decision of the transplantation. So I will pass that. So in fact, it's difficult for the echocardiography to give the same information for all these parameters. It's a statistical approach. But for the standard treatment, it's, for us, it's helpful, but it's not for all the situation. But perhaps we can improve that. Perhaps we have some way to use the intracavitary gradients, perhaps, to best understand the gradient pressure and the pressure. Perhaps we use some global assessment of the diastolic function. Perhaps can we, in the future, use the stiffness of the heart, because today we just use the relaxation. Perhaps can we use some data mining, like these authors, to understand, according to the clinical results, the patterns we have. We can all put all the patterns in a very big database, and at the end say, include the result of the clinical investigation, and to have some patterns that mean something more precisely than today. Today we just analyze with no data mining. So perhaps the data mining will help us in the future, but we have to inject all our data in a database. It's not the case in our clinical centers. Today we just analyze a peak velocity. We do not take in account all the flow. But perhaps it could be interesting to have a physiological model that we can include or associated with our patterns to help us to understand the pressure and not just the peak velocity. It's one other way. So, in conclusion, I will say that for us, the echo is relevant, but it depends what we want to do with. For the standard treatment, for the standard decision is relevant. We do that every day. But if we have to transplant, to do some difficult or expensive treatment, we have to do catheterization. We have no other solution today. But in our clinical activities, it's a good technique. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I think this was a nice overview. And I think especially for the students, I think it's really important to see now that actually things are not that easy. Eh? It's like a lot of projects from engineers work around, let's get another way to measure one parameter or a nice segmentation here or there. And at the other hand, when you look at cardiologists that want to publish, they also want to publish a study measuring one variable and saying that this would replace everything else because that gives them citations and things like that. While the clinician, at some point when you need to make a decision on a patient, you're faced with sometimes difficult to get data, very contradictory data, data that needs to be integrated, guidelines which are not clear at all. So there is a big discrepancy between all these things. Eh? And I think also as researchers, we should actually open our eyes to this kind of things. And then as you mentioned already, like one way which probably will work for some parts of it is using data integration and machine learning. But the other thing that I think we also have to work on more is like trying to say how do we integrate this information, and also how do we say like some of the information might be either difficult to measure or the measurement error might be big because some of these images are noisy and things like that. So also trying to understand where variability comes from and how it would influence by combining it with other parameters. And I think we really have to also try to take that point of view, because in the end, that's the bread and butter from the non-invasive cardiologist, is trying to integrate this data and then make a decision on an individual patient. Oh. And a lot of research that we do is actually not really helping for that. And of course, for the companies, I can imagine that it's also not that easy to provide something which would integrate that, because at some point it goes towards interpretation rather than just doing measurements. So I think it's a really complex thing, but it's really important that we're faced to this and that we try to see what's the best way to deal with that.
Or perhaps to focus on problem we have, for example, the problem for the measurement of the pulmonary pressure. It's a big problem, the clinical activity. Not all problem, but this topic is today a problem, because we have nothing to measure it. We have to do catheterization, it's a lot of. So perhaps it's a research topic for the engineer to do something for that.
Yeah, I think that's where there are a lot of challenges. It's in the integration of all this data. And there are certainly many things to do. So when I was looking at this E over E prime ratio, it's actually a very trivial way to integrate two different things, which are the flow and the motion.
It was trivial. It was a approach.
And it doesn't work. But I mean, first, okay, you do a ratio, but so you lose the dimensionality of your data. You could keep the two axes, it seems, I mean, at least from an engineering point of view. And I'm sure Sergio would comment much better on that. So you lose the curve. That's the other thing. You just take one value.
And the thing is that you don't integrate, especially with, for example, EE prime. In some patient populations, it works perfectly, but definitely not in all. So the thing is, again, it's data integration. You have to know when you can use it and when it means what. And the only thing is doing that is while trying to understand the hemodynamics together with the size and the deformation of the ventricle. So everything comes down to data integration instead of doing one measurement. Every cardiologist wants one measurement, because then instead of 20 minutes, you can do it in 5 minutes and you earn four times as much money. But the thing is, life is not that easy. So that's what we really have to work on.
I think we need to include a physiological model, because we record the data, and as Bart says, sometimes it works, sometimes it do not work. But if you have a model, perhaps you will correct something.
But you need to find the right model, the right type of models, because there are many types. Going to very detailed finite elements is, I think, not doable in 20 minutes. Any other question? Okay. Or comment?
Like to have it in 5 minutes to earn more money, but it's impossible. They don't pay more money to us. Just kidding. Another difficulty that we were discussing with Ada is when the patient is also in arrhythmia. I'm not sure if you already discussed that, but so for example, atrial fibrillation. So every beat has different loading conditions, so it changes a lot. No, so it. Us as a cardiologist one, or so the physicians want to keep it simple, but it's impossible. Absolutely. So this is why we need a little bit of your help.
Yes, we have many cases in where it's not we have not the answer or the measurement. So arrhythmia, for example. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much again, Eric. Let's go for coffee.
Innovation and you. Philips.